It's my pleasure to introduce one of our CDG experts who's also been at some of the world panel conferences on CDG, and we were very honored to have him travel over here to be able to present some very interesting research on liver studies. And so Dr. David Cassiman is going to be joining us, and he's a medical doctor and PhD working in the Department of Gastroenterology and Hepatology at the University Hospitals in Leuven. His main clinical activity is to see adult patients, and many of them have very diverse inborn errors of metabolism, among which glycosylation disorders exist. He's appointed professor and teaches at the University of Leuven and University of Hasselt. Welcome, Dr. Cassiman.
Okay, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm very honored to be invited to give this talk. The talk is divided in two parts. The first part is talking about what the liver is and what liver disease is, and then in the second part, we will talk more about what this all means for CDG. So don't worry, it's not all going to be about the liver, it's also about CDG. And as Andrea said, I live and work in Belgium, and as I noticed traveling to the US now and then, that people in the US don't know what Belgium is, I thought I would start by introducing Belgium a bit. It's normal that you've never heard of Belgium, because the last time Belgium was mentioned in history was in the first century before Christ by Julius Caesar, who mentioned that the Belgian warriors were the fiercest among the Germanic and Celtic warriors. And he thought that that was the case because they were not exposed to traveling merchants or to the culture of Rome, because they were hiding in the woods. In the meantime, time has passed and a lot has changed, and maybe you know Belgium better because of all the beer and all the chocolate and strange architecture and Tintin, the Smurfs, cyclists, art, etc. So this is Belgium now. We're no longer the fiercest warriors, but I wanted you to know that there is such a thing as Belgium, and it's a country in Europe. Okay, so now something about the liver. As you can see, the liver is this big gland in the upper right quadrant of your abdomen, and more in detail, if you look at the liver and the anatomy, then we see that there is something very special about the liver. It has two supplies of blood. One is the hepatic artery, so oxygen-rich blood coming in, and the other is the portal vein, which is a very special system or blood vessel system that drains all the blood from the spleen and the gut. So all the nutrients that come in through the gut, they are first taken up in the portal blood, and then they pass through the liver, and only then they get to the system. That's important because a lot of the problems that we see in liver disease have something to do with this portal vein. That's why I thought I would mention it. And then we have also excretion from the liver. That's all these green tubes here that form the bile duct, and the bile duct then secretes secretes bile into the gut, and this helps with digestion, but it's also a way of getting rid of all kinds of toxins from your system. For instance, drugs get metabolized by the liver, and then these metabolites can function in your body, or they can just be excreted with the bile back into the gut, and then they leave the body through the feces. So that's also important to know that about the liver. And then at the exit, there are big blood vessels that end up right next to the heart in these hepatic veins or the caval vein. So I know you're all medical experts by necessity. I thought I would just start with the very basics of liver disease and the liver, just so you have some time to relax, and then we can move on to more complicated stuff. So don't be angry with me for making it all so simple, okay? Hepatology is very simple, and it's not as complicated as the neurology we had this morning, so I'm just telling you simple stuff. So what does this liver do? It does a lot. It's like a chemical factory in your body, actually. And the liver produces serum proteins and coagulation factors. And I put this in red because it's important for CDG. It will come back. It also stores some vitamins and iron. It has a role in immune tolerance. Very important, as I said, detoxification of endogenous toxins like ammonia. They go through the liver and then they're changed into urea that you can then pee out. But also all the drugs we take or all the toxins we take in with our foods, they are detoxified in the liver and can then be excreted into the bile and then leave the body again. And then the liver is also very important for our energy metabolism. It can handle all kinds of nutrients like protein, carbs, fat, vitamins, and so on. So this is really a chemical factory that sits between the outside world, so the gut and the feeds that come in through our mouth, and the inside world, which is the blood and the rest of our bodies. Okay? So, sometimes it happens that your liver gets ill. This can be acute, so just a short-lived illness of the liver. For instance, hepatitis A, you become jaundiced, you feel tired, and then it disappears again. We have a situation called hepatitis, which basically is the problem where cells within the liver die, and they burst, and they release all their contents into the blood. And these contents we can then measure just by taking your blood and measuring enzymes, for instance, in the blood. The enzymes that you have been mentioned several times already in the past days and that are important for measuring liver function or for measuring how many liver cells are dying and releasing their contents are AST, also called GOT, and ALT-GPT. So these are liver function tests that we can measure in blood and that reflect how many liver cells are actually bursting. And then there's a situation called cholestasis, where the production of bile and the excretion into bile and then into the gut are defective. And we can also measure that by measuring in the blood bilirubin, which is a yellow pigment that is actually a waste product of your hemoglobin. So the hemoglobin is the red pigment that colors the blood and that is the substance that transports your oxygen. So bilirubin is a waste product that accumulates when your bile excretion doesn't proceed normally. And then there are enzymes that end up in the blood, like alkaline phosphatases and gamma GT. Those go up too when bile production isn't normal. And this is a situation we call jaundice. And here you see that the whites of the eyes of this person here have become yellow. And that is what is called jaundice. And that is actually caused by accumulation of bilirubin when the bile excretion of the liver does not proceed normally. So we know now the terms, hepatitis and cholestasis. What kind of complaints do patients have when their liver is ill? Well, that is a bit disappointing. You can have liver illness for many years without any complaints, so it's sometimes difficult for patients to notice that their liver is ill, or for doctors to think of liver illness when patients come with these type of complaints, like tiredness. 30% of the population is tired, so this is not a very specific symptom of liver disease. If we have to suspect liver disease in all these tired patients, we have a lot of work as hepatologists. Itchiness can come up, especially when there's something wrong with the bile production. This is very severe itchiness where patients really scratch themselves, especially in the evening and during the night, and they cause wounds just by scratching. Jaundice, as we discussed, and then very late signs of years of liver disease can be the accumulation of abdominal fluids. We call that ascites. Patients can develop bruises and can bleed spontaneously because the liver has to produce all these coagulation factors. And if there's no liver left to produce all these factors, you can have bruising and spontaneous bleeding. Sometimes patients become confused and they can show some cognitive decline or, well, confusion where they don't know anymore what's day and what's night. This is normal in small children. They will wake up in the middle of the night. But in adults, this is less normal that they are awake at night and sleeping during the day. And this confusion can even go to a state of coma when the liver really doesn't function anymore. So patients with liver disease can have vague complaints for years before it becomes clear that they become jaundiced, they have fluids in the abdomen, etc. So in most cases, it's more it's more relevant to detect liver disease before it reaches this stage, okay? So, and what do we call the symptoms or the complaints that or the presentations that we can see in liver disease? It will come back later on. So hepatomegaly, that just means that your liver is bigger. So there's a bigger liver because of accumulation of things, because of disease, so big livers. Elevated liver tests we call hepatitis. I've told you that. Cholestasis leads to jaundice, you know that. Then there is a thing called steatosis, which just means that there is a lot of fat accumulation in the liver, so you get a fatty liver, like foie gras. So the liver, we feed geese with a lot of corn to make them fat and to make the liver fatty. That's what happens in some patients. And then when there is scarification of the liver because of chronic hepatitis, for instance, then we call this fibrosis. This is a bit of scar tissue. If there's a lot of scar tissue, we call it cirrhosis. You've heard of cirrhosis, no? Mainly in the context of alcohol abuse, but any chronic liver disease can lead to cirrhosis. And then there's a situation called liver failure, when there are actually not enough liver cells left anymore to perform all the functions of the liver, so the patients become jaundiced, they develop clotting problems, and they become confused. So in this triad of symptoms, we speak of liver failure, that's end-stage liver disease. This can also develop very quickly if there's a major insult to the liver, for instance, taking way too much paracetamol. That has a different name in the US. Tylenol, yeah. If you take like 30 times the normal dose of Tylenol, you can develop liver failure, and this can become fatal in a matter of days to weeks. Okay, so that's liver failure. If you take a biopsy of the liver, you take a hollow needle and you punch a hole into the liver, you can take out a little sausage of liver tissue, and then you will see that there are these walls of hepatocytes, so liver cells, and the blood flows from this portal vein here through these walls of hepatocytes into the central vein, and then it goes out of the liver, and this is what the liver is supposed to look like. If the liver becomes fatty, you can see that these hepatocytes are filled with these blobs of just lipids, so fat. What happens if your liver is ill and stays ill for a long time? That is a situation we call chronic hepatitis, and because there are liver cells dying all the time, the liver tries to compensate this by producing scar tissue. That is what happens, for instance, if we cut ourselves. Also, our skin will produce scar tissue to close the gap. That's the same thing that happens in the liver, and this scarification we call fibrosis, and if there's plenty of fibrosis, we call this cirrhosis. I will show you a picture right after. And then there is not enough functional liver tissue left, and so the blood proteins, so the liver produces almost all the blood proteins. The most important blood protein we call albumin. It is not glycosylated, but most of the other proteins that the liver produces are glycosylated and end up in the blood, and we can measure them there. So the blood proteins go down, clotting factors go down, and then also detoxification capabilities of the liver go down for ammonia and exogenous toxins like drugs. When there is cirrhosis, a situation can arise that we call portal hypertension. You remember the portal vein drains the spleen and the gut and takes all the nutrients to the liver. If the liver becomes hard because there is all this scar tissue in the liver, then the blood doesn't flow through the liver as easily anymore, and then the pressure in the portal vein rises, and that's what we call portal hypertension, and this has a few complications of its own. So this is, for instance, this little sausage here is a needle biopsy of a cirrhotic liver, and you see that the hepatocytes are form these nodules, and around these nodules you see all this scar tissue. So there's a lot of scars, there are nodules of hepatocytes, that's cirrhosis, and it comes with a lot of complications. And here you see again that this is the portal vein. It drains the spleen and the guts. And if the blood is not able to flow through the liver as easily anymore, it might find other ways out of the portal vein. And sometimes these ways out can cause trouble. For instance, if you get these varices, so dilated veins in your esophagus, these veins can rupture and can bleed very, very heavily, and that is one of the complications of chronic liver disease that can be fatal. The spleen will grow bigger, so that's a situation we call splenomegaly, big spleen, and then blood can also find ways out through hemorrhoids. So these are, this is the same thing that happens in your esophagus. Veins dilate, but this is at the end of your gut, so near the anus, and these veins can also bleed profusely. So, as I said, portal hypertension is one of the complications of chronic liver disease, where the liver becomes cirrhotic and blood doesn't flow through the liver as easily anymore. These esophageal varices, so these dilated veins in the esophagus, can cause life-threatening bleeds. And important to know as family or as patients is that these varices, you don't feel them. It's not like they block your swallowing or that your food gets stuck in your esophagus. No, you can only see them if you go and have a look in the esophagus by endoscopy. Yeah? So there are no symptoms associated to having these varices, and you will only know if they start to bleed. And then it's too late. So you have to know if you have varices or not by going in with an endoscope and looking at your esophagus. And then when there's a lot of pressure in the veins going into the liver can start oozing fluids, and these fluids end up in this space you have in your belly, and then this can become a large volume, up to 10, 12 liters of fluids in an adult can collect in the abdominal cavity. We call this ascites, and that you can actually, before it's 12 liters, you can actually see it very easily on an ultrasound. Important to know is that while CDG, for instance, as a cause of liver disease, cannot be treated yet, it is important to know that these varices, you can prevent them from bleeding by taking drugs or binding them with little rubbers. And these ascites can be treated too with drugs. So the complications of liver disease are treatable and preventable. So it's important to know whether or not there's liver disease, and especially when this liver disease is reaching a final stage. So finally, we've reached the point where we are starting to talk about CDG. Up to a few years ago, it was known that CDG can also present with liver disease, but there was no systematic information about liver disease in CDG. So with a group of people, we decided to look into the literature and look how important liver disease is in CDG on the whole, and then more specifically in bigger groups of patients like PMM2. You all know that CDG can affect many parts of your body, but one of them is certainly the liver. Your liver can be big, you can have scar tissue in the liver, it can become end-stage scarification of the liver, like cirrhosis, you can have hepatic failure in some types of CDG, and you certainly can have problems with thrombosis and bleeding, and knowing that all the coagulation factors, or almost all of them, are produced in the liver, there is an association between liver disease and trouble with bleeding problems. So that's when we wrote up this paper, Liver Involvement in CDG, Systematic Review of the Literature, and I will give you the highlights so you don't have to read it all. Important to know is that the liver produces all these proteins that are secreted into the blood, and most of the proteins that are in the blood are actually produced by the liver, and almost all these proteins are glycosylated, so there is certainly a link between CDG and liver or liver disease. Looking into more detail into the hepatocytes, I think you cannot see this, so you might have to look up the publication anyway, but these are all the steps in glycosylation. So this is the endoplasmic reticulum, this is the Golgi, and then these are the proteins that are produced into the blood or into the plasma membrane, and all the squares are round enzymes of steps in this whole production process, and patients with defects in these enzymes can develop liver disease, and there are many of them. The red ones are the CDGs with mainly liver disease, and the purple ones are the CDGs with a lot of medical problems one of them is potentially liver disease. What we found going through the literature is that 22% of all CDGs can present with liver problems, so 1/5 of them. It's not all of them, but it's a chunk of them. And then two groups, CDGs that affect mainly the liver or CDGs that just affect also the liver. And I listed them here. Liver mainly is like the MPI CDG. Sometimes this is so severe in these patients that they have to be transplanted. The liver has to be replaced. And then there's the TMM199, CCDC115. Also, one case of transplantation has been published. And then there's the ATP6AP1. So these have mainly liver disease. So these are actual liver diseases that hepatologists like me should be thinking about. They don't always do, but they should be. And then, then there's the CDGs that also affect the liver or can also affect the liver. Certainly PMM2, PGM1, and then many of the ALGs and the COGs can also affect the liver. So this is the highlight. And then this was looking back into the literature of the last 40 years. And then we decided to maybe try another approach of getting similar information directly from you all. So there was a questionnaire that was launched. I'm sure you've heard of this. People have been bombarding you over the last year, asking you to fill out the questionnaires. And these are the results, and they have been collected by Dorinda. So probing the extent of liver involvement in CDG through an electronic patient caregiver questionnaire, and these are actually the results that you have given us. Interesting to see is that in CDG patients, looking in the literature, we saw that 22% of CDGs can have liver disease. Asking you, instead of going through 40 years of medical literature, just asking you over a few weeks, we found out that indeed this percentage of patients with CDG have had liver problems. In the majority, or most of these problems were hepatomegaly, so big liver. That isn't too bad. Huh? So having a big liver does not affect your quality of life or your life expectancy. Half of these patients had increased transaminases, so these ALT and AST that I've been talking about, they were raised in the blood. 1/3 had some scarification that was known. 1/4 had some fatty liver changes, and then there were a lot with changes in coagulation factors, of course. 18% of these had cirrhosis, so many CDG patients have evolved to the stage of end-stage liver disease, which is an important insight. And then 12% had this serious situation of portal hypertension, which is important to know because, as I said, you cannot treat the cause of portal hypertension, but you can treat the complications or the consequences. So it's important that this figure is important. And then liver transplantation, this is very small, so I'll read it out to you. Liver transplantation was suggested as an option for 3 PMM2 CDG patients, 2 MPI CDG patients, and 1 NGLI1 CDG patient. So apparently, some of these patients develop end-stage liver disease or liver failure at the end of their liver disease so severe that they are considered for liver transplantation. So liver involvement in CDG is not entirely irrelevant, it seems. Yeah. So, and interesting to see if you compare the data from the questionnaire and then the data from the literature review, you can see that these numbers are actually within PMM2 because that's a more consistent group. We had almost 200 patients and families responding to the questionnaire. 70 or 80 of them were PMM2 families. So within the PMM2, we saw that these data are very similar. And even if you do statistics, which we don't like to do, but if you do that, you can see that there is a very clear correlation between what you can learn from looking into 4 decades of medical literature or just asking the families. So you did a very good job. Yeah, thank you for that. And I suspect that this will be the way of the future. Instead of like publishing cases or case series, you just go to the families and the patients and you ask them. Okay, so important to remember is that some patients with CDG develop portal hypertension. That is important to know. 10 patients with cirrhosis in PMM2 is also more than we expected to find. Liver transplantation was not done, but was discussed with several CDG patients. And so liver disease in CDG may not be so irrelevant as we maybe thought. So get checked. What do you have to do to get checked? It's very simple. Next time blood is drawn in your family member or yourself as a patient, you have your liver test checked. This is this ALT, ALT, AST, ALT, alkaline phosphatases, bilirubin. You will get these slides, so don't worry, don't jot it all down. But ask your doctors to check liver tests in the patient. You could do a liver ultrasound, which is really non-invasive, it's simple. You could have a liver ultrasound done every 1 to 2 years in kids, every 3 to 5 years in adults. That's also minimal effort, I would think. Then there is an exam called FibroScan, which is basically similar to an ultrasound, where the patient from the age of 4 or 5, so not in small kids, you cannot do this in small kids, but from the age of 4 or 5, it's an ultrasound, and you give small taps between the ribs, and that allows you to measure the elasticity of the liver. So if your liver is hard, full of scar tissue, that is important to know, and you can measure it just by something similar to an ultrasound. So that is something to consider. And then if you know that the CDG patient involved has cirrhosis, you should perform endoscopy to see if there are these varices, because you can do something about the varices, and you can prevent them from bleeding by giving drugs and by placing these rubber bands. So the complications of liver disease are treatable or preventable, even if the cause isn't yet. So we're looking into treatment of CDG, but you don't need treatment to do something about these possibly fatal complications of liver disease. So of course, I didn't all do this myself. I have to thank my mentor, Jacques Jaken, who's also one of the founding fathers of the CDG community, I would say. I have to thank Eva Morava, who was previously a colleague of mine in Leuven, but to preserve her youth and beauty, she moved to the Mayo Clinics, where it's minus 20, so she has a fair chance of doing so. And then, of course, we have to thank the whole team of people who did the work on the literature review and on the patient questionnaire. Dorinda, Rita, and the whole Vanessa network, I call it here. Yeah. And then, of course, all you patients, families, and the colleagues in Leuven and all over the world for helping us collecting data. And I'll be happy to take some questions if there are still questions left. And
yeah, we're very thankful for Professor Cassiman for coming all the way over here. It's really our first presentation we've ever offered at one of our family conferences just focusing on liver. So I know that we have a few questions, so please feel free to come on up to the microphone.
Hello. Thank you very much for the detailed explanation about liver disease in CDGs, particularly PMM2. And MPI, CDG. My question is specifically as a participant in the study, my son who participated, is I know some of the uniqueness in some of the children's issues that you touched upon, like itchiness, right? Our son was diagnosed with eczema. Well, we don't know if he has eczema or he's just itchy. And as well as with the liver being a little bit more fatty, we're being given contradicting information like, well, you need to have a high calorie diet. So our son particularly does not drink milk. He drinks half and half. And he's supplemented with a lot of caloric intakes. And I know other children who have tubes, NG tubes, are also given high caloric intake because that's what is recommended. Does that lead to fatty liver? Or is it because there's fatty liver and that's why you need to, what comes first, right? The chicken and the egg argument.
Well, fatty liver is a symptom and it's not, in itself, it's not dangerous. You have to make a distinction between fatty livers that go with elevated liver tests and progressive, like, scarification of the liver. And then there's a whole population, especially in the Western world and especially also in the US, that have fatty livers and do not develop progressive scarification of the liver, progressive fibrosis. So you have to make a distinction there. And for CDG kids, it can be important to feed them well for many reasons. If there is a fatty liver and the liver tests are normal, or there is no no indication of progressive liver disease or hardening of the liver, then I certainly wouldn't refrain from giving them high-calorie diets just because there's a fatty liver. It's not as if you will treat the fatty liver by giving high-caloric diet. We don't know for now how to treat fatty livers, and there are probably many kinds of fatty livers, and we're unable to distinguish between them. So I wouldn't say that having a fatty liver in itself is a reason to do anything with the diet. If there are reasons to change the diet outside the liver, it's always good to just follow up on what's happening to the liver. If you start a high-caloric diet with a lot of lipids in a kid with a fatty liver, I would check the liver tests like every 2 to 3 months when you go in to see the doctor anyway, and when bloods are taken anyway, you could just follow liver tests. But in itself, it is important to know that having a fatty liver or having a bigger liver is not a problem. It does not necessarily mean that this child or adult will develop liver disease or will develop liver problems in a later stage. And then itchiness is a very difficult symptom. People or kids can be itchy for hundreds of reasons, and before you become itchy because you have a liver disease, you can detect changes in the blood like high bilirubin or high bile acids in the blood, and the itchiness that comes from the liver, you can try a few things to treat that, but first you need reasons to treat it, so you need reasons to think that it's due to liver disease. But that can be done by just looking in the blood for these toxins that are accumulating in the body because the liver isn't able to detoxify and secrete them.
Two more questions.
So when children with various CDGs who are on hexose therapies whose transaminases and glycosylated coag factors are going to a more normal or normalized, they probably still could generate some fibrosis, and so ultimately things may look great, and then trouble. So how often would you recommend liver biopsies to follow that?
We don't easily do liver biopsies anymore because if it's just to look for fibrosis, there are other means now, non-invasive means to follow up fibrosis. So we do fibroscans. You could do it on a yearly basis. The only limitation is that you can only start doing it when the child has reached the age of 4 or 5 years. And it's not painful or anything. It's just that they need to have enough space between the ribs to allow for this probe to give taps to the liver. So we don't advocate repetitive liver biopsies because there's a huge issue with sampling error. So you take a little sausage of liver tissue, and if you take a sausage right next to that, there can be a huge difference in fibrosis score under the microscope. Well, actually, it's the same liver. Yeah?
Yeah, because one of the children has made that I'm caring for has made incredible progress, but it's about 3, and, you know, was weeks away from liver transplantation. So, you know, one of the key questions is, I don't want to wait.
How long to wait?
Yeah, well, I mean, the thing is, there could be precipitous deterioration, and then there may not be a liver. So that's the question, you know.
Well, okay, fair question. But patients are stratified for liver transplantation based on their biochemical evolution.
Right.
So you have the MELD score, which is made up of clotting and creatinine and bilirubin. So these are objective scores that will go up, and then your patient will proceed to transplantation. So if these are unaffected, then you actually have you don't have much reason to attempt or to envision liver transplantation in your patient. So you wait until the liver disease is severe enough to really affect the quality of life and the life expectation of the patient. And you don't need biopsies for that.
Morale?
Hi, my question should be simple, I think. I have a daughter with ALG8, and she had very abnormal liver function tests as an infant, and then they've normalized, but we were always told sort of generally stay away from Tylenol, acetaminophen. And I wonder, you know, kind of practically, is that still true? How much is a maximum daily dose, and is there a benefit to like doing that like a rectally to kind of avoid first pass metabolism through the liver? Does that even matter? I don't know.
Well, what we tell patients always is to take half of the maximum dose. So for adults, maximum dose is 4 grams of paracetamol. We tell our patients with end-stage liver disease to maximum take 2. So, and then for children, the dose depends on their weight. And well, you need a pediatrician for that. Oh, yeah, that's true.
15.
Yeah. So
that's it.
You take half of the maximum dose for children,
okay,
depending on the weight.
How about rectally versus?
Yeah. What about rectally? Rectally versus orally?
Oh, no, that should be similar.
Because doesn't matter.
In the second round, it just passes the liver. So.
Okay. And also, Richard Waddell told me to say hi.
Sorry?
Richard Waddell told me to tell you hi.
Thank you. Yeah, Professor Yakin told me to tell you all hi. I forgot. Okay.